Fantastic. Thank you everyone for listening in. It's such a privilege to be here and to talk about the wonderful work that Dr. Taru has been doing. Very excited to share a little bit of the work that we've been doing in India. Dr. Taru, if you could move to the next slide. So before we get into our vaginismus healing program, which is something we're going to feature today, a quick note about who we are at Proactive. We are a digital health clinic, and our thesis is digital healthcare is going to be the preferred mode of healthcare for consumers as they move online. This is something that's already happening so naturally. Most of our patient journeys today, even in India, start online with a quick Google search. We have more than 60 million women today transacting on digital platforms in India, and online consultations are growing at 4 times the growth rate of physical consultations. And this is not surprising. Women are definitely more online, shopping online. 40% of the e-commerce retail spend today in India is by women, and more women in India have bank accounts than ever before, enabling online transactions. This is super exciting for us as we build Proactive. And without any further ado, I'd like to hand over to Dr. Taru, who is a gynecologist and obstetrician with more than 8 years of experience, who's been doing some fantastic work with us. And I'd love for her to speak about it.
Namaste. Hi from India. Thanks a lot, Achita, and for the generous introduction. I am a gynecologist and also the lead therapist at the Vaginismus Healing Program that we have started at Proactive. So vaginismus is not a term that's routinely recognized by a lot of people in the community or even in the medical fraternity. If you talk about vaginismus, so they'll just probably pause for 30 seconds before coming down, okay, this is what vaginismus means. So what is vaginismus? In simple terms, it just means inability of a woman to allow vaginal penetration of a penis during sexual intercourse or a tampon or a finger during vaginal examination or simply a menstrual cup or a tampon. This is in spite of the fact that she really wants to do it. She's unable to do it. What is the reason behind this? As you can see with the image on the right side of the screen, penis is trying to enter inside the vaginal canal, but you can see some red colored muscles around the vaginal canal. These go in a state of spasm. Every time there is an attempt to enter the vaginal canal, they go into a state of spasm because of probably it's almost like a defense mechanism to prevent any perceived or anticipated pain or injury. Now, why does this happen? It does not happen to all, but it does happen to some women. Why does it happen? So on the left, you can see there is something called a cycle of pain, which is at the core of vaginismus. So what is the cycle of pain? Due to some painful experience related to the vulval area or the entire perineal area, or some belief that I will be hurt when penetration happens because of anything, there will be pain. So whenever there is an attempt to penetrate with a finger or with a penis or with any other object, due to the intense anticipation of pain and fear, these muscles go into contraction, leading to even more pain. And the vaginal opening literally closes and it becomes like a wall. A lot of patients with vaginismus actually describe this phrase that my partner felt that I was closed like a wall. And so many marriages remain unconsummated, so many relationships remain unconsummated because of this. And of course, the woman experiences a lot of issues with gynecological examinations and using menstrual cups, etc. So, as I said, the impact can be on the individual herself, leading to feelings of shame that in our society, a lot of femininity is equated to fertility. So if she cannot produce a child, there is a lot of shame involved with it. So she can go into depression, anxiety, panic, low self-esteem, low confidence, feeling like not being adequate. It can be also severely impactful on the relationship, leading to a lot of frustration, a lot of fights and conflicts between the partners, and ending up in divorce and separation. When the impact is so huge, it's very important to find out how vaginismus starts, because only when we know the cause can we actually treat it in a more wholesome way. So what are the causes? They can be broadly divided into psychosomatic or physical. So physical causes could be anywhere from inflammations or infections or endometriosis, any of that. It can be easily ruled out by a simple gynecological visit. Once that is ruled out, the other spectrum of causes is psychosomatic. Psychosomatic, the word itself means something that starts with the mind and manifests in the body. So psychosomatic causes can be broadly classified into trauma, any past trauma related to the vulval or the perineal area. So a lot of women report sexual abuse or any kind of molestation, any kind of painful vaginal examinations in clinics, or simply vulval vaginal injuries. All of this can set that cycle of pain moving in their heads. The second issue could be negative beliefs about sex. Some people, probably some girls in their adolescent time or early adulthood, hear conversations that, oh God, the first night was so painful, or the first experience is just so painful, you have to just go through it. So when they hear that sex is a painful act, somehow that memory, that thought remains in their heads and leads to this spasm of the muscles, almost as a defense to prevent injury or pain. The second issue is women who have grown up in very conservative orthodox cultures where sex is, premarital sex is a taboo, and this is thought as dirty or immoral. So suddenly after marriage, when they have to engage in a penetrative intercourse, it's very difficult for them because their muscle memory has been accustomed to not having sex. So these are broadly two main reasons why vaginismus occurs. Of course, there could be more reasons. So now, why did we start the vaginismus healing program with Proactiv? So for, a lot of people ask me why, of so many things I could have done as a gynecologist, I am focusing on vaginismus healing. So the story starts with my own struggle with vaginismus. Even though I am a gynecologist and my husband is a psychiatrist, you know, the very two fields which actually deal with treating vaginismus, we suffered and struggled with vaginismus for the first 7 years of our married life. It was hell. It was so difficult. At that time, it was even very difficult to find resources online, and given our professions, also to take out a lot of time for healing. When I actually did heal after 7 years, it took me less than 4 weeks of consistent effort to heal this. That's when it struck me, why did I suffer for 7 years? I mean, I wish someone had told me how to do this in such a streamlined way. And that's when I decided that someday I want to help other women in the same boat. And thanks to Proactiv, they had the courage to launch a program like this, which is slightly sensitive. And we have been able to complete our first batch. I'll just come to that. In India, as I have said, there's a lot of unawareness about this issue because it's not commonly recognized that women are not able to penetrate. I mean, this is not something people think about. Is that even possible? So not just in the community, even in the medical field, a lot of people don't know why vaginismus happens. A lot of times when someone approaches, usually a gynecologist in the clinic, like few of the experiences that even I have gone through has been that the gynecologist has simply inserted fingers inside and told me, okay, now it's dilated. I have done it. You will be able to do it. And it was so painful that it increased my fear of pain instead of helping me. So some people just focus on, okay, just relax, it will happen. And the woman is never able to heal. So lack of awareness. Second, lack of resources. If you just Google the term vaginismus, you will find hardly any articles before 2019. It's only last year that a group of feministic organizations have come out with few informed articles. Before that, that was also not there. So if a woman has vaginismus, where does she go? Who does she contact? There is also a lot of taboo to go to sexologists or psychiatrists. So where does she go? Where does she go? Also, sometimes when the treatment actually starts with a gynecologist or a psychiatrist, what I have noticed is most of the time the focus is just on dilating. You take these dilators, just dilated. It is not a wholesome integrated approach, and that is why the success rates are not that good with such programs. When it's done in an integrated way, success is bound to come. So let us just go through what we have done in our program. So we have made a 8-week program, and we have kind of designed a 4-step process based on my own experience of healing vaginismus, which happened under 4 weeks, once I put consistent efforts. And of course, it has all, it is based on all evidence and science from textbooks. We have kind of designed an integrated approach in which the first thing is, of course, one-to-one individual therapy with the woman and explaining the concept of vaginismus to her, helping her understand where it could have started. In case there is history of severe trauma, we refer her to a group of good psychologists and counselors on Proactive or around her. We teach her to relax, and of course, body image, acceptance, a lot of things come into the healing process. Second would be a patient support group, which is incredibly important and a lot of times overlooked. Something that I didn't have. I sometimes feel that if I had this support group, I would not have taken 7 years to heal. So patient support group, it happens every week with other women in the program, in the 8-week program, who are exactly at the same stage doing exactly the same thing. The third is a partner support group, which is also very important because a lot of times partners' voice are not heard in the vaginismus story. So when partners see other partners in the same boat, then probably the sense of frustration decreases and more awareness of the process comes. And lastly, we do provide very good quality dilators. And now, as one program has ended, we have created a long-term support group program for them so that they can stay in the process and, you know, not relapse into the same issues. In today's era of COVID, an online program becomes all the more important, especially because a lot of people fear literally going out of homes and seeking help in clinics. So when a program comes to them through their laptops or their mobile phones, it becomes very easy to do the program in the privacy of their homes. Secondly, hardly any cost involved due to traveling, due to lodging, boarding in different cities. The support provided with the family remains when you do it from your home versus if you have to go to another city and do it. And lastly, now in India, because of the digital boom, everyone has a mobile in their hand. It's so easy to engage in an online program. Also, in our program now, because of the online and the digital world, we have women from different countries participating, like Australia, participating in our program. And thanks to the online program, now you can access the best experts across the country instead of having to travel to find one expert. So The next thing I'd like to share here is some outcomes of our program. So in the batch one, we have had five women, out of which one participated with a partner and the other four were single. Now, a lot of people might ask why single women are participating in vaginismus program. As I said, whether or not they are in relationships, spasm of the vaginal muscles, the PC muscle, can happen even with attempted penetration of a tampon or a menstrual cup. So a lot of women do come to us with the request that I want to use sustainable menstrual products. So help me heal vaginismus. So out of these five women, two women actually fully healed and the three others are in their process. In the batch two, nine women have registered and we have just started the program this week. A few things that they, the ones who healed, they shared with us was these two women were in their process of healing for almost last 5 to 6 years. And they have suddenly healed in under 8 weeks. So what was the difference? So what they have shared is, first of all, lack of a support group. They just loved the support group because of so many reasons. Support groups kind of decreases the sense of shame or the sense of being a victim. From why me, it becomes more of, oh, I'm not the only one. There are so many others who also have this. I'm not the only one on earth. Support group really helps in this. Second is hearing other stories provides a lot of insight, a lot of lessons that the woman can use in her own healing process. There is a lot of friendship that gets created. So I know that the members in our support group, they have had like 1 a.m. and 2 a.m. chats about this. Oh, it hurts me. I'm trying to use the dilator. So the friendships that get created between these women, the sense of solidarity and the sense of community, this is what probably helped them heal so fast. And of course, once the women start to ventilate and speak out and not feel ashamed of what has happened and treat it like any other physical condition that anyone would have, right? So then once the shame goes away, then the healing starts. So this is one recommendation from our program that we'd like to share with everyone, that it is critical to healing and we cannot have a vaginismus program without a support group. Second is partner support is extremely critical, as I've said, because their voices are not heard. So sometimes they also need to speak out that they are frustrated, that they are not happy, because sometimes just saying that is a proof that he doesn't love the girl, you know, so he's just not able to say anything. Firstly, that, and second, clarity about vaginismus. Why does his partner have vaginismus? So when he sees so many other girls having it, it kind of makes it normal for him too. Next important lesson is, a lot of times we have heard that just bear with it. It will get better with time. It doesn't. As we have found in the cycle of pain, once there is pain, the next time more pain is experienced. So it doesn't get better. So bearing with the pain is not the answer. Helping the woman to first become painless or neutralize the pain. So there are many techniques for it, whether it is using gradual desensitization with dilators or the various relaxation techniques or Kegels exercises, so many things. And finally, this is not the end point to just make it painless. The end point is pleasure. We have to probably help the woman realize that a sexual intercourse is not just to give, but also to feel the same pleasure that the partner is experiencing. And finally, a lot of people say that just put a local anesthetic gel, just put lignocaine gel, it will numb everything and just do it. Is that the goal? Is that the goal, to numb things and do it? No. So that these are some very important lessons from the program that we would like to share with everyone who's interested in working with this. Thanks a lot. Namaste.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Dr. Taru, for the wonderful session. And it was indeed a you know, very interesting and touching topic to sort of touch upon in our session, and we would really thank you for doing that. We have one question from the audience. I'd like to bring it up to you. So in a country like India, where, you know, people are hesitant in talking about sexual health in itself, how is the program addressing the barrier of acceptance? Because, you know, first of all, females coming out and acknowledging the fact in itself is something that, I mean, would take another path to resolve that entire space. So what do you think? What are your thoughts?
Achita, would you like to speak or?
Sure, I'm happy to start, Dr. Taru, and hand over back to you. You know, fully appreciate that point. And as maybe some of the first, you know, one of the first people in the country sort of testing these waters, a lot of our work is also education and awareness based. We recently, for example, collaborated with a media house to release a video. And there was, within 2 days, we had over 70 women reach out to us to be put on the waitlist for this program. Even through our own social media channels, we've had close to 30 women reach out as well. So it is definitely taboo, and educating women is really the first step towards asking them to get on board the healing process. Dr. Taru, would you like to add to that?
Yeah. And in this, I think, again, the online platform has made it incredibly easier for women to seek help, because I know a lot of members of our groups haven't told this to anyone in their family except probably their partners or one close friend. So online or digital world does provide an option of not just making it so public that it becomes impossible to do it. To leave your house and go to a sex therapist or to a psychiatrist, it's not easy, because everyone comes to know. But when you do it online, it can be done discreetly. So I guess once they get empowered, then they can come, just like me, come online and speak about the story to the whole world. But I think initially it does need a lot of privacy, which the digital world does provide.
Thank you. Thank you for addressing the question, and really thank you for, you know, becoming a part of the summit and addressing a topic such as vaginismus. And it was really great listening to the insights of your session. And now I would like to move on to our next session. Thank you both. Thank you so much for your cooperation.
Thanks a lot.
Thanks, Irfa.
Thank you.